right. Well, good morning. We are small in number but mighty in commitment this morning. We welcome you to this morning's hearing. It's a review of federal hydraulic fracturing research activities. This is the fourth meeting of the Energy Subcommittee this Congress, and today we welcome our friends from the Environment Subcommittee to discuss this cross-cutting issue. Some of them are still at a classified briefing on Syria and North Korea. We expect them to join us any minute. The reason we're starting on time and not waiting for them is we're tremendously time constrained this morning due to votes coming up, and we want to have an opportunity to take advantage of the expertise you're providing here today. A primary recurring theme from our earlier hearings, which focused on energy markets and related technology subsidies, was the incredible transformation of the U.S. energy sector as a result of hydraulic fracturing-enabled shale production. So today we're building on this theme and drilling down into the science of hydraulic fracturing, pun intended. In April of 2012, President Obama signed an executive order creating a senior-level task force charged with coordinating federal actions related to the development of unconventional natural gas. Concurrent with the President's announcement, EPA, DOE, and the Department of the Interior signed a memorandum of understanding committing to development of an interagency plan to guide implementation of the administration's $45 million budget request to study environmental impacts associated with unconventional oil and gas production. The agencies committed to release a draft of the research plan by October of last year and to complete the final plan by January of this year. Today, a year after the President's original announcement, the administration has not even released a draft version of its plan for public comment. So, Congress and the public have very few details regarding the administration's ongoing activities in this area. In addition to last year's $45 million request, the President is seeking an additional $38 million in fiscal year 2014. Our concerns regarding these activities are simple and straightforward. Before Congress redirects tens of millions of dollars for this research effort, the administration must tell us what it wants to spend the money on. Bringing sunlight to these activities is especially important given the administration's terrible track record of unsubstantiated allegations when it comes to hydraulic fracturing. Pavilion, which is in my home state of Wyoming, is at the center of this storm. In late 2011, EPA put Pavilion in the national spotlight with a draft report implying that fracking was somehow responsible for the quality of water in the area near town. However, in the days and weeks that followed this announcement, the state of Wyoming, industry, and other federal agencies exposed EPA's study as deeply flawed. Former Administrator Jackson even admitted to me during questioning at another committee that the EPA was not confident it had discovered groundwater contamination in Pavilion related to fracking. And she further said, "We have definitely not discovered it in groundwater, or rather in drinking water." Given its serious flaws, I have called on the agency to abandon the report and return to a collaborative effort with the state of Wyoming on how to resolve these issues around Pavilion. The people of Pavilion deserve resolution, and the state of Wyoming deserves deference for the hard work it has done to ensure that oil and gas development in our state is done safely. I certainly plan to follow up with EPA and ensure that they get it. Policymaking related to fracking should be driven by open public debate based on peer-reviewed science, not political agendas. That is why we're here today, to ensure the administration's fracking-related research activities are appropriate, balanced, and transparent. On a related note, I do want to express frustration with the lack of cooperation from EPA in planning this hearing. More than 4 weeks ago, we invited Bob Sussman to testify at this hearing on behalf of the agency. And despite this extended advance notice, Mr. Sussman's role as EPA senior policy representative on the interagency group that we're here to discuss, the agency refused to allow him to participate or to provide an explanation for its refusal. And we appreciate Dr. Teichman. Now, did I pronounce that correctly? We do appreciate your presence here today. But EPA's lack of cooperation is just unacceptable. And it only raises further questions regarding the agency's transparency and ultimate intentions regarding fracking. I do, again, want to thank all of our witnesses for being here today and look forward to today's discussion. And now I'd like to recognize the gentleman from California, Mr. Swalwell, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman, for holding this hearing today. And I also want to thank our witnesses for being here. I appreciate the opportunity to examine the important topic of hydraulic fracturing, often called fracking, in greater detail. I agree with those who say that when it comes to our country's energy resources, we should take an all-of-the-above approach to energy production. The emerging natural gas boom obviously provides an exciting opportunity for our nation, not to mention California, my state, to create jobs and diversify energy options for both consumers and industry over the next several years. I believe that wherever it is possible, if we can make it environmentally safe, we can make it happen. However, when it comes to fracking, I believe we need to proceed with extreme caution. We have to be careful that if we are to extract this resource safely without inadvertently polluting either our drinking water or the environment. And in California, of particular concern is what fracking can do to cause earthquakes or to activate or reactivate previous fault lines. It would be very short-sighted to produce energy in California via fracking, only to find out later that it could cause such damage, which also means that maybe perhaps fracking may be better for one state than it is for another, and that's also a conversation and a topic I am interested in exploring further. But for that reason alone, it is imperative that we know as much now, as early as possible, about what fracking can do to our fault lines in California before pursuing short-term gains. And this is why I think this multi-agency effort is so important, and I applaud President Obama and the administration for leveraging its diverse areas of expertise to determine the best practices for hydraulic fracturing going forward. I understand that the agencies testifying today have met their internal goal of submitting a draft plan before the end of 2012. And the final plan is now in the last stages of coordination with the Office of Management and Budget. In the meantime, this draft has already informed the President's budget request for each of these agencies. And the important research priorities that you've collectively identified are being addressed even before the release of the final report as you continue to work in close coordination with each other. I look forward to learning more about each of your efforts, discussing these important issues with you today, and reviewing the final report. And with that said, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Swalwell. And as you know, this is a joint hearing, so the chair now recognizes the chairman of the Subcommittee on Environment, Mr. Stewart, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and welcome to the witnesses. Thank you for your being with us today. And to the chair, thanks again for holding this hearing on what I think is a very important issue. Unconventional oil and gas development enabled by hydraulic fracking is a rare bright spot in our otherwise gloomy economy for over the past few years. Given the importance of this issue, I too am disappointed that the EPA declined to send the witness that we invited, Mr. Bob Sussman, the Senior Policy Counsel to the EPA Administrator, to testify. While I hope the agency had a good reason for its refusal to make Mr. Sussman available, they did not share this reason with us, and that troubles me. And I think it invites suspicion and it begs to be answered why. I can only hope that this will prove to be an exception rather than a trend. This is especially concerning as the EPA's past and ongoing hydraulic fracturing studies and investigations demonstrate a cart before the horse approach to the science that should make members think seriously about whether a blank check for the administration is good policy. The shale gas revolution has not only brightened our economic prospects and created sorely needed jobs, it has strengthened our energy security. And as a former Air Force pilot and officer, I understand how important that is, as I'm sure do most of you. Thanks to fracking, the U.S. is now poised to surpass Saudi Arabia and Russia as the world's largest oil and gas producer in just the next few years. This could dramatically alter the geopolitical landscape to the great benefit of American interests. Yesterday, we held a hearing to examine the science of climate change And whatever one's position is on this issue, there is no denying that fracking is helping drive reductions in carbon emissions. U.S. greenhouse emission gases are at their lowest level since 1994 and have dropped 12% since 2005. In fact, from 2005 to 2011, the U.S. decreased its carbon dioxide output by more than any other nation, including those countries that have implemented aggressive green energy agendas, such as Germany and Spain. In light of these facts, it's both ironic and troubling that many of the most passionate advocates for action on climate change also oppose fracking. And I wish that I understood this, but frankly, I don't. This should give pause to the EPA and other agencies that seek to hinder the development of our unconventional natural gas resources. To do so not only negatively impacts our economy, but it increases emissions and undercuts major advances toward energy security. Rather than search for problems that do not exist, the EPA and this administration should recognize that shale gas is a solution. It's not the problem. Production, not regulation, has led to a reduction in greenhouse gases, and market forces, not restrictions, quotas, and carbon trading schemes, those are the things that have positioned the U.S. for a global leader in oil and gas production. Again, market forces, not restrictions. I again thank the witnesses for joining us today, and I look forward to your testimony. I hope that you recognize, as I do, that searching for a problem as a pretext for regulation rather than focusing on science is a waste of time and a waste of resources, and it runs counter to all of our interests as well as to the national interest. And with that, I thank the gentlelady for the opportunity to be here, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. The chair now recognizes Ms. Bonamici.
Thank you very much, Chair Loomis and Chair Stewart, for holding this hearing. I'm pleased to have representatives from the federal agencies appearing before the joint subcommittees today to discuss their multi-agency plan to research hydraulic fracturing and unconventional oil and gas. Hydraulic fracturing has led to a significant expansion of drilling for gas and oil in the United States, unlocking huge natural gas reserves that have reduced the cost of natural gas domestically and resulted in economic improvement across many industries. The successful development and application of this technology, however, has been accompanied by an insufficient understanding of the potential impacts that hydraulic fracking might have on our environment and our health. The debate about environmental health and human safety issues has escalated as we've heard concerns related to groundwater contamination, induced seismicity events, and I share Mr. Swalwell's concerns as someone who has constituents along the Cascadia subduction zone, well integrity, and potential negative impacts to the health of workers, just to name a few. According to the Energy Information Administration, it's estimated that shale gas will supply almost 50% of our gas in 20 years. If that prediction is accurate, it's even more critical that this boon in natural gas production be accompanied by a clear development of best practices to identify and curb potential negative impacts. It's my hope that the multi-agency research plan will address these very important questions in order to ensure the continued prosperity of the industry while preserving the health and safety of the general public. Hydraulic fracturing emerged as a commercial success in large part because of federal investment in fracking technologies. The success the government had in aiding the fracking industry is an example of how public-private partnerships can work to advance science and engineering and turn nascent technologies into an economic driver. Although I'm a strong proponent of reducing our country's dependence on conventional gas and oil, I hope we make similar commitments to developing clean energy technology with a similar focus on preserving human and environmental health. Diversifying our energy supply and protecting public health go hand in hand. In closing, I'm pleased that the administration is calling upon the expertise of our federal agencies to ensure that we have the best scientific information available, use cutting-edge technology, and develop best practices for extracting this plentiful resource in a manner that's safe for our workers and the environment. I look forward to hearing how the agencies plan to research and address these issues, and with that, I yield back and look forward to the testimony. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Bonamici. I now recognize the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I have a very brief opening statement. It is difficult to overstate the incredible benefits of the fracking energy revolution that is underway across America. A recent report found that the Eagle Ford Shale development in Texas is now producing 700,000 barrels of oil and natural gas liquids every day, up from zero just 3 years ago. The economic benefits and job opportunities associated with this shale boom, not just in Texas but across the nation, is arguably the brightest spot in an otherwise still stagnant economy. Unfortunately, a widely publicized handful of unsubstantiated charges that fracking pollutes groundwater has led many to question the safety of this practice. The EPA is at the center of this debate, linking fracking to water contamination in at least three cases, only to be forced to retract their statements after further scrutiny. It is against this backdrop that we are here to consider the administration's request to spend nearly $40 million across several agencies studying the safety of hydraulic fracturing that would be carried out under a long-delayed and still unreleased research plan. We all want to ensure safe and responsible production of oil and natural gas, but the combination of the administration's track record on fracking and the delays associated with developing these plans provide cause for concern. I look forward to hearing how we can support this energy revolution and avoid any unnecessary delay in its evaluation by the federal government. Thank you, Madam Chair, and yield back.
Thank you, Chairman Smith. Now for a little housekeeping. In front of each member are packets containing the written testimony, biographies, and truth in testimony disclosures for today's witnesses. As always, we'll alternate between the majority and minority members in terms of asking questions. We'll recognize those members present at the gavel in order of seniority on the full committee, and those coming in after the gavel will be recognized in order of arrival. And one more little thing. If there are members who wish to submit additional opening statements, your statements will be added to the record.
Madam Chairman. Madam Chairman, I am chairman of a hearing that's about to happen in a few minutes from now. And I'd just like to thank you for your leadership in calling this hearing today. And I will be submitting questions for the record and reading the testimony of the witnesses. But I have to leave, and I'm sorry for that.
I thank the gentleman. Mr. Rohrbacher is a long, distinguished member of this committee, and we appreciate his presence here this morning and look forward to the submittal of your questions and the responses to them from the agencies here present. Thank you, Representative Rohrbacher. If there are additional opening statements, we will accept them now. Very well. That being said, it's now time to introduce our panel of witnesses. Our first witness is Dr. Kevin Teichman. Now, did I get that right? It's Teichman. I had it right the first time, didn't I? Would you please say it again?
Teichman.
Teichman. All right. Thank you. Dr. Teichman is the Senior Science Advisor for the Office of Research and Development at the EPA. Our second witness is, now here we go, I'm going to give it a shot, and please correct me, Mr. DeHoracius?
DeHoracius.
DeHoracius. Welcome. Mr. DeHoracius is the Acting Deputy Assistant Secretary for Oil and Gas in the Office of Fossil Energy at the Department of Energy. Our third witness is Dr. David Russ. Did I get that right?
Perfectly well, thank you.
Thank you. Regional Executive of the Northeast Area for the United States Geological Survey. And our final witness is Dr. Robin Ikeda?
Ikeda.
Ikeda. I'm going to write Ikeda. Dr. Ikeda is the acting director of the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry at the Department of Health and Human Services. And we are, again, grateful for your presence here today. As our witnesses should know, spoken testimony is limited to 5 minutes each, after which members of the committee have 5 minutes each to ask questions. Your written testimony will be included in the record of the hearing. And now I would like to recognize our first witness, Dr. Teichman, for 5 minutes. Welcome.
Good morning, Chairman Lummis and Stewart and other distinguished subcommittee members. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you today about EPA's research activities related to hydraulic fracturing. Among others, oil and natural gas are important sources of energy that will continue to play a vital role in our nation's energy future. The extraction and development of these resources must be done safely, responsibly, and be guided by the best available science. In April 2012, DOE, DOI, and EPA signed a memorandum of agreement to develop a research program devoted to unconventional oil and gas production. Under this MOA, the three agencies are collaborating to provide information that will support sound policy decisions by federal agencies, state, tribal, and local governments, the oil and gas industry, and others to ensure prudent development of these sources while promoting safe practices, human health, and the environment. The three agencies are coordinating their research planning, focusing on each agency's areas of core competency, and collaborating on research with each other and others. Last July, the Tri-Agency Steering Committee held webinars for three different groups of stakeholders: industry, state and tribal governments, and not-for-profit organizations. At that time, we described the research areas we thought should be studied and asked each group, what are the most important research questions that can be addressed in the short term and the long term? What would be the most useful research products, and what research is your organization pursuing? In addition, the members of the steering committee and its technical subcommittee continue to participate in technical conferences, meetings, and workshops devoted to this topic, at which we have presented our research areas and asked the above questions. Specifically, EPA has taken steps to coordinate with other federal agencies throughout the development and implementation of our drinking water study. For example, DOE and DOI are participants in the technical workshops related to our study. These workshops are devoted to analytical chemical methods, well construction and operation and subsurface modeling, wastewater treatment, water acquisition modeling, and hydraulic fracturing case studies. In the MOA, the three agencies committed to the development of a research plan that would, in brief, synthesize the state of knowledge, identify data gaps, prioritize research topics, and determine future goals and objectives. The research plan is still under development. Work to date to develop the plan has been very helpful in both coordinating the research efforts of the three agencies and developing the President's 2014 budget request. In FY 2012 and 13, EPA's research related to hydraulic fracturing is focused on carrying out the congressionally requested study of the potential impacts of hydraulic fracturing on drinking water resources. This research is focusing on assessing any potential impacts as well as identifying the factors that may affect the severity and frequency of such impacts. Work is underway to answer the research questions listed in the study plan for this effort. EPA released a progress report in December 2012, which provided an update of the ongoing research. A draft report of results is expected in late 2014, which will synthesize our research results together with the available scientific literature to inform answers to the research questions listed in the study plan. As shown in the study plan, there are important questions outside the scope of the current study that are of high priority to stakeholders. Therefore, the tri-agency research plan will include research on potential impacts on air quality, human health effects, water, and ecosystems. This broader perspective is reflected in the FY 2014 budget request. The FY 2014 budget request is $14.1 million and 24.9 FTE for EPA to conduct UOG research. Resources are requested for the drinking water study, water quality and ecological studies, and air quality studies. These research areas are among those identified as high-priority research topics in the tri-agency effort and represent EPA's 2014 contribution to that effort. As mentioned earlier, a draft report of the drinking water study results is expected in late 2014, and additional FY 2014 resources will be used to revise the report as needed to reflect public and peer review comments. The remaining FY 2014 requested resources will be used to better characterize the composition of wastewater and wastewater treatment of residuals, including solids, from hydraulic fracturing and UOG operations and air emissions from these operations. In conclusion, I believe the prudent development of our oil and natural gas resources can make a critical contribution to meeting our nation's energy needs. I am proud to be part of the research effort that will help enable the development of these resources in a way that maximizes the positive impacts and minimizes the potential negative ones. We are pursuing this work with the best available science and the highest level of transparency, and will continue to collaborate with our federal partners and stakeholders to address the highest priority challenges to safely and prudently developing these important resources. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Teichman. Now, I I'm going to try one more time. I love these American last names of global derivation. They're so much fun. And I think I have Dr. Teichman and Dr. Ikeda down. So I'm going to make one more run at Mr. DeHeratis. Did I get it right?
That's correct.
Right. The chair now recognizes our next witness, Mr. DeHeratis.
Thank you. I want to thank the chairs, the ranking members, and the members of the subcommittees for inviting me before you today to discuss the critical role that the Department of Energy, Office of Fossil Energy, in collaboration with the Department of the Interior and the Environmental Protection Agency, is playing to improve the safety and environmental performance of our nation's unconventional oil and natural gas resources. Federal coordination and collaboration is critical to successfully addressing the challenges associated with the development of unconventional oil and gas resources. To this end, the President signed an executive order, which has already been referenced this morning. On the same day, our three agencies signed a related memorandum of agreement on collaborative research to better identify and address the highest priority issues associated with the safe and prudent development of unconventional oil and gas resources. This collaboration will address a subset of unconventional resources, namely shale gas, tight gas, shale oil, and tight oil, and a robust federal research and development plan is under development. Each of the three agencies has a unique set of core capabilities relevant to this effort and will focus on those tasks that are most relevant to their respective skill sets. At the same time, the agencies will work together on tasks that require collaboration. The President's 2014 budget request includes $12 million for DOE to fund this effort. Shale gas development has brought new options to American consumers along with new environmental concerns. This is a period of great opportunity for the prudent development of our country's resources, which could make a positive contribution to our economy, jobs, and balance of trade. But to get these benefits, we must do this right. Through targeted research and development, DOE can work with our agency partners, industry, and other stakeholders to help ensure that we are meeting our shared goal of safe and responsible development of these resources. The successful application of horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing technologies has enabled production to be extended to vast volumes of unconventional resources that were previously uneconomic to produce. To help ensure that development of our resources is done in a safe and responsible way, DOE is implementing research in areas that will include water quality and availability, air quality, induced seismicity, and mitigating the impacts of development. The Department is carrying out research directed at quantifying and understanding the environmental and safety risks of shale gas and shale oil development, improving our understanding of emerging and developing shale plays, and increasing the efficiency of technologies for treating hydraulic fracture flowback water. Our partnership with Atella to successfully treat hydraulic wastewater, which I detailed in my written statement, is a good example of the kind of projects we are pursuing. We are also focused on improving environmental performance by mitigating impacts related to wellbore integrity and zonal isolation to protect shallow groundwater resources and reducing water usage, air emissions, and resource degradation through improved unconventional resource stimulation that appropriately matches the technology to local geologic and hydrologic conditions. This work is a critical component of DOE's portfolio to advance the environmentally sound development of unconventional oil and gas resources and will support ongoing programmatic efforts. DOE has research experience and capabilities in drilling and production technologies, green technologies, complex systems, imaging, materials, earth science, and engineering. DOE capabilities in drilling and production technologies include experience and expertise in quantifying, evaluating, and mitigating potential risk resulting from the production and development of shale oil and gas resources. That includes multi-phase flow in wells and reservoirs, well control, casing, cementing, drilling fluids, and abandonment operations. The Office of Fossil Energy is committed to developing the science and technology that will allow the nation to use its abundant fossil energy resources in a way that meets its energy needs, including sustaining a robust economy and ensuring environmental responsibility. We believe that continued progress will help in addressing issues of energy and environmental security and assure the maximum benefit to the U.S. taxpayers. This completes my prepared statement. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, and your testimony provided a great segue to Dr. Russ about the geological issues. Now, you're from the Northeast region, so you have some experience with the Marcellus area, I assume.
That's correct.
We're looking forward to your testimony, Dr. Russ. You may begin.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to appear today to review federal hydraulic fracturing research activities, the progress in coordinating research called for in Executive Order 13605 and the associated interagency memorandum of agreement, and the Department of the Interior's role and responsibilities in carrying out this work. Interior supports the responsible development of natural gas as a clean energy source, so it is important to understand this resource as well as investigate and evaluate potential environmental impacts associated with shale gas development. The interagency collaboration builds on the core capabilities of each agency to ensure that our efforts are complementary and non-duplicative. The USGS does not regulate, nor does it manage lands or other resources. The USGS conducts scientific research and assessments of geologically based energy resources, including unconventional resources such as shale gas and shale oil. USGS programs that monitor and investigate the nation's surface water and groundwater resources are fundamental in determining water availability and quality, including the potential impacts of resource extraction on drinking water, healthy ecosystems, and the sustainability of living species. USGS core capabilities also include the assessment of land use change, critical to understanding the impacts of energy development activities on ecosystems and the socioeconomics of communities and the investigations of earthquakes. To meet the challenge of safely and responsibly maximizing the contribution that unconventional oil and gas resources make to the total energy supply, DOE, EPA, and Interior are developing a collaborative research framework. The three agencies are building upon current work and identifying and prioritizing new research and development activities that support sound management and policy decisions by federal, state, tribal, and local entities. The goal is to produce decision-ready information to help ensure the prudent development of energy resources and the protection of human health and the environment. Our effort encompasses a number of research topics, including the U.S. unconventional oil and gas resource assessment, characterization, and management, water quality, water availability, air quality and greenhouse gas emissions, effects on people and their communities, ecological effects, and induced seismicity. Interior, through the USGS, has ongoing and planned activities covering a range of research topics. Specific activities in fiscal years 13 and 14 are described in my written statement, but in general, USGS envisions a continuation of prior work that builds on core USGS competencies. For example, the USGS has historically had responsibility for assessing the undiscovered, technically recoverable hydrocarbon resources of the nation and will continue this function for unconventional resources. The USGS will identify and model water quality changes associated with the life cycle of unconventional oil and gas production and will determine the impact of well injection and produced waters on groundwater quality. The USGS will support stream gauge baseline monitoring in states where production is ongoing or planned and will develop predictive tools and statistical models for estimating the amount of water needed for drilling and production operations. The USGS will also conduct wastewater toxicity testing and vulnerability assessments to identify and prioritize regions, aquatic communities, and wildlife habitats that have the greatest potential for impact from unconventional oil and gas activities. Decades of research have demonstrated that the deep injection of large volumes of fluids underground can induce earthquakes. The USGS will calibrate models against field and lab data to support the development of best management practices for minimizing induced seismicity. The USGS will analyze seismic data to update the national probabilistic seismic risk maps in ways that account for induced earthquakes. In conclusion, the research activities required to address questions related to hydraulic fracturing draw on the core capabilities and competencies of USGS scientists in geology, seismology, energy resource development, biology, and hydrology. I have briefly described many of our current and proposed hydraulic fracturing-related efforts in my written statement, but a number of other USGS programs also contribute to an improved understanding of these issues. Thank you again for the opportunity to discuss the activities of the USGS and the interagency effort to understand this important natural resource and the potential impacts of its development. We appreciate your interest in and support for our science, and I would be happy to answer any questions that members may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Russ. And now we turn to Dr. Ikeda. Ikeda. I thought I had yours. I'm sorry. Ikeda.
Yeah, that's very good.
Correct?
Yes, correct.
Thank you. You are recognized, Dr. Ikeda.
Good morning, Chairwoman Lummis, Chairman Stewart, and members of the subcommittees. Thank you for the opportunity to present this testimony. I'm pleased to represent the Department of Health and Human Services to provide you with an update of our work related to hydraulic fracturing. Although our work related to hydraulic fracturing at HHS is limited in terms of the amount of work we do, we provide technical assistance and scientific expertise to our federal colleagues and others. President Obama has made clear his commitment to the safe and responsible development of our natural gas resources as part of the all of the above energy plan. I'll briefly describe the missions for the three HHS components that conduct work related to hydraulic fracturing. CDC ATSDR focuses on protecting people and communities from environmental exposures to harmful substances. The National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, NIOSH, which is also part of CDC, is responsible for preventing work-related injury, illness, and death. As part of NIH, the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, NIEHS, conducts basic, applied, and clinical research on the health effects of environmental exposures. None of these three agencies have regulatory authority. Our work related to hydraulic fracturing is in primarily four areas. First, we coordinate with federal, state, and local partners. We define research gaps and other information needs. We evaluate site-specific health conditions and potential exposures in communities, and we assess potential workplace exposures. If we identify harmful exposures in the community or the workplace, we recommend actions to protect communities and/or workers. Our work related to hydraulic fracturing has been in collaboration with federal, state, and local partners. HHS has provided technical support to the multi-agency work group on research related to unconventional oil and gas development. Although HHS is not a member of the steering committee, we have provided technical and scientific input to this initiative at the committee's request. In addition, HHS has provided input on the design of EPA's study looking at the potential impacts of hydraulic fracturing on drinking water resources. HHS is also working to better define public health research gaps and other information needs related to hydraulic fracturing. In 2012, we participated in three meetings to assess the public health research needs in this area. Other participants at these meetings included experts from industry, academia, and the government. Along similar lines, NIEHS provided a small grant to the University of Rochester for a one-year project to help understand the health and hydraulic fracturing-related information needs among various health professionals, government officials, and communities in New York, North Carolina, and Ohio. Information from this project will be used to develop recommendations about how to respond to the public's need for information about health and hydraulic fracturing and to guide future research. ATSDR's site-specific activities focus on whether health hazards exist from exposures to harmful substances in air, water, and soil. Typically, this work has been done at the request of EPA and/or state agencies. If public health risks are identified, ATSDR makes recommendations that individuals, organizations, or government agencies can take to protect health. ATSDR also follows up with local residents to make sure they understand the findings. In the last two fiscal years, ATSDR has completed more than 300 of these site-specific consultations, but only a small proportion of these consultations, eight sites in total, have been related to health concerns in areas with ongoing hydraulic fracturing activities. Our work at these eight sites has generally fallen into three categories: sites where there are concerns about the water quality, those where air quality is an issue, and then those where there are potentially explosive hazards, such as methane. NIOSH works closely with industry colleagues to assess potential workplace exposures and, if indicated, recommends actions like safe worker practices, use of protective equipment, or engineering controls to protect workers. To address an existing lack of information about dust and chemical exposures associated with hydraulic fracturing, NIOSH initiated an effort to better understand occupational exposures among oil and gas extraction workers. With respect to hydraulic fracturing, exposure to airborne silica during the fracturing process has been the primary focus of NIOSH work to date. Additional NIOSH activities related to hydraulic fracturing include developing a research agenda and evaluating or examining other potential worker safety hazards such as falls, chemical exposures, or fires and explosion. In conclusion, HHS, working with our federal and state partners, communities, and industry, supports the President's commitment to the safe and responsible development of our natural gas resources as part of the all-of-the-above energy plan. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm happy to answer your questions.
I thank the witnesses for their testimony, and the chair now recognizes herself for the first questions. I want to start with each of you. Having been an expat member of the Interior and Environment Appropriations Subcommittee, a lot of them are going to be related towards spending. In FY13, the EPA, DOE, and USGS were given a combined $45 million for fracking-related research at your agencies. Can each of you from those agencies tell us how much your agency plans to spend this year related to this proposal?
We'll take it, I assume, in order that we testified earlier. Chairman Lummis, and
thank
I believe
you,
I got that
Teichman.
Correct.
Yes, Lummis. Rhymes with hummus. Yeah, thank you.
And let me also thank you, and in a moment of bipartisan support, Representative Bonamici as well, for rocking the red as Washington Capitol fans. I appreciate your red blazers here this morning. And one other very brief personal note, I thank all the committee members for their work prior half an hour to this hearing. As one who was on the Tokyo Metro system the morning that the sarin attack occurred, just happened to be at a different station, and whose son worked for Senator Frist when the letter with Ricin was opened in that office. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate the seriousness of your work. In FY 2013, the EPA will spend $6.1 million and 14.9 FTE to continue the drinking water study that we began at the request of Congress in the FY 2010 appropriations report.
Thank you, Dr. Teichman.
Good morning. In fiscal year 2013, the Department of Energy plans to spend $10 million to support the effort, the research areas that are support the topics that are in the framework.
And Dr. Russ?
Thank you. Yes, our continuing resolution sequestration information is still being sent over, I believe, from OMB to the Congress, but our intention is for fiscal 13 to spend approximately $8.6 million.
Okay. A follow-up for you, Dr. Russ. Last year, I was part of a discussion with Dr. McNutt in Interior Appropes on whether we should grant USGS the extra money for these studies. And I was a little concerned about duplication, but I really was most supportive of the USGS portion because Dr. McNutt told me on the record that the money would be used to develop best practices for wastewater injection and seismic activity. And you alluded to those continued uses in your testimony. So that, as I understand it, is still the plan going
yes, it
forward?
Is. Yes,
no
it is,
changes there?
No.
No expansion there?
There will be a modest expansion, I think, in our induced seismicity component, where we have a little bit more money this year than last to look at the impacts of induced seismicity, and by looking at things like injection rates of fluids underground to better understand the impacts potentially producing earthquakes, and working with EPA as well as industry to understand best management practices to potentially reduce the occurrence of these types of events.
Okay. Well, and I'm a landowner in a split estate situation where the oil and gas is being developed, and so for somebody like me who owns the surface but not the subsurface, obviously we're very concerned about wastewater injection issues and appreciate the USGS expertise in that area. Dr. Teichman, I also had last year a discussion on fracking with former Administrator Jackson at the Interior Appropriations Subcommittee. It was not quite as satisfying to me as my exchange with Dr. McNutt. It was in that testimony that Ms. Jackson admitted the EPA had found no conclusive evidence that fracking had caused contamination in Pavilion, Wyoming. This after the huge expose in the New York Times, indicating after they released their draft report, that Wyoming was not in as positive a position as people thought it should be. Exactly how does the EPA intend to use this research money in a way that doesn't duplicate its other studies related to fracking, especially does not duplicate the lack of peer-reviewed science and the lack of transparency that's the hallmark of the Pavilion Draft Report? The Pavilion Draft Report, especially its release as a draft report that was extremely critical and quite frankly wrong, and created this big flurry of concern about fracking, and now has been completely impeached by subsequent work. How can you assure me that doesn't happen again?
Perhaps the best thing I can do is tell you the interactions we've had with our science advisory board on the EPA drinking water study that I'm a part of. I would note for you that in Dr. Ikeda's written testimony, it refers to the fact that the Pavilion, Wyoming situation is not part of the EPA drinking water study. And so I wish to draw that distinction to your attention.
And I would wish to draw the, sure, the point that Lisa Jackson, when I asked her, is the drinking water contaminated by fracking in Pavilion? And she testified no. So what the problem I'm having is the EPA is not distinguishing in people's minds drinking water versus groundwater, non-drinking groundwater. And furthermore, the fact that EPA was probably responsible for contaminating some of those wells during the testing process adds to the further frustration. And, you know, Pavilion is frequently held up as the poster child for bad practices and bad consequences when it was hugely prematurely released. It has not been peer-reviewed. It was exaggerated. And, in fact, it appears that EPA itself was contaminating those wells in their own efforts. I'm hugely frustrated with the EPA and its treatment of my state and of fracking in general. It's as if it tried to create an example at Pavilion to exacerbate or raise the profile of fracking as a national issue without the science to back it up. So the distinction between groundwater and drinking water is important. My time is way up. Excuse me. I yield to the ranking member, Mr. Swalwell, with my apologies.
Thank you, Chair Lummis, and no apology needed. I am interested in this discussion as well. And as I mentioned in my opening remarks, perhaps with fracking we may find that the drinking water and groundwater contamination concerns would apply to any state that has or participates in fracking. But then once you look at individual states, you might find that there are issues that are unique to those states. And I'm talking, of course, about California. And so, Dr. Russ, as I noted in my opening statement, my constituents in California are particularly concerned about the possibility of man-made earthquakes. I represent the Hayward Fault. That's in my district. And it's a internationally known fault line. Nature and physics give us enough problems as it is. So how significant is the potential for induced seismicity, and what are some of the ways that we can sufficiently address that risk, as well as what do we know now and what do you want to know in the future? And I was encouraged to hear that there may be some funding that can be put towards further studies.
Thank you, Mr. Swell. Yes, induced seismicity we regard as a very important topic for research. We want to know more about how many earthquakes are occurring in areas where fluid is being injected underground, wastewater fluid is being injected. We want to know the rate in which those events are occurring and the size of those events. We want to know if one earthquake that's been induced can trigger another earthquake, and can it be a larger, more damaging earthquake. We want to know the relationship between the pressure and the rate of injection and the volumes of water and waste materials that are injected underground, so we can calibrate those rates against the potential occurrence of earthquakes.
What do we know now?
We know now that there's relationships between the occurrence of these induced earthquakes and the locations of subsurface injection wells. We know that it's important to understand if there's an active fault nearby injection sites, which could be that fault might be ruptured and trigger an event. We know that there's been a significant uptick in the numbers of small to medium earthquakes in the central United States, which we believe are associated largely with induced earthquakes.
Great. And also, Dr. Russ, in my state, as in many, water is a precious resource, and fracking is an extremely water-intensive process. If these activities were to expand into Northern California, do you have a sense of where the required water resources would be obtained from and what the impact on local water availability would be?
Very good question. Water availability is one of the key research topics that are in our draft research report. Each area, as you mentioned, is unique in terms of its occurrence, the nature of where the aquifers are and where the various units that contain water, whether streams or subsurface sources. So we would have to take a look at that individual area to determine what are the actual occurrences and the problems. Also, seasonality of the weather in a given area affects water availability, so the weather is an important component as well.
Will the research plan also examine alternative fracking fluid technologies that would be less harmful to the environment?
Yes, that's the intent.
Okay. Also, will the research plan examine recycling of wastewater that would be produced in the fracking process?
I'm not sure if that's if I have the knowledge on that one.
Okay. Any other witness? Dr. Teichman?
Yes, I believe the research plan will include the ability of recycling wastewaters as a way of preserving water acquisition and not introducing additional chemicals into the hydraulic fracturing process.
Great. And going back to where I started for all witnesses, would you agree that at least right now, as I mentioned, we must proceed with extreme caution, but that we may find that some states are better suited if you can address the groundwater and drinking water concerns, that some states may be better suited for exploration through fracking rather than other states?
I'll take the first stab and then turn perhaps to Dr. Russ, and to state that certainly the geological formations are different in different states, and the approaches to be taken, therefore, should be dependent upon what the different states' geology is. For those who are traditionally drilling much deeper than the aquifers, then I think we would expect that practice to certainly be more positively environmentally friendly than those that might be drilling into them.
Great. Actually, I'll yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. I thank the ranking member. Next, we go to the chairman of the Environment Subcommittee, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I want to go through a couple questions, but I want to divert just, if I can, and do some very quickly. Dr. Russ, I'd like to come to some of the things that you have said. You know, I'm afraid that you would leave the impression with American people, being familiar with this hearing today, that there's great risk of massive earthquakes because of water reinjection and hydraulic fracking. Is that your intention here with your testimony?
No, it is not.
Because we agree that this is very, very immature science, and we really can't draw any conclusions yet at this point. Is that true?
I would say that's true in terms of a potential damaging earthquake.
Okay, so there's some speculation, but very, very little evidence to draw any conclusions to this.
We're very early in our research
program. Okay, thank you for that. A couple others, and I'll, again, make these very, very easy if I could. I'm supposing that none of you would disagree with the president's belief that greenhouse gas emissions pose a global threat. Would that be true? None of you would disagree with that. Okay. And then let me, if I could, just cite a point from 2005 to 2011, which I know that you're all familiar with, of course. The greenhouse gas emissions have decreased by 12%. And over the same period, global greenhouse emissions have actually increased significantly. And a lot of the reason for this is because of our abundance of natural gas. Then could we agree that it is a good thing, it would be good policy, that it was something that we'd want to facilitate everything that we can do to increase our natural gas production? Would we agree that that's a good event?
Let me just state in my testimony that I believe we should indeed develop our energy sources in a way that maximizes the positive benefits and certainly minimizes the negative. I would, however, mention, if you ask me which is the cleanest form of energy, it's energy conservation.
Okay, but the policy being is it's good for us to facilitate natural gas production. Any of you disagree with that? Okay, thank you then. Then in your testimony, either written or in some cases your testimony today, you praise the benefits of natural gas, but you caution that, as you said, we want to reap these benefits, but we want to, quote, do it right. And given that these practices have been going on for decades, this isn't something that's new. There are some new variations of the technology, but this isn't dramatically new or different than what we've been doing for quite a lot of time. And to my knowledge, there are no proven instances of groundwater contamination. And that, as we've just said, greenhouse gases have been declining thanks to natural gas. And so I would ask you, I mean, what have we done wrong? We say we want to do it right, but what are our concerns? What have we done wrong up to this point? And invite any of the panelists to try and answer that.
Let me try and start by stating that I believe that the technology of drilling very deeply and horizontally with new drill bits and using hydraulic fracturing is something which the combination of has allowed us to see a much greater resource than I would say we knew of decades ago, to refer to your question.
Which is a great thing.
I am glad to see domestic energy supplies that may reduce our reliance on foreign supplies. Absolutely, I agree with you in that regard. To that extent, I think these newer combination of technologies, we just need to make sure we are maximizing the positive benefits of the exploration of natural gas and oil, by the way, and minimizing the potential for environmental harm at the same time.
Okay, so there isn't anything particular that you think we've done wrong up to this point. Would that be true?
I think that's true, although I would think that work that I've heard industry talking about and I hope is being implemented to have stronger casings or additional casings when they go through aquifers to recycle the wastewater, to go ahead and use greener fracking fluids, I would very much encourage work in that direction.
And I think all of us would, by the way, Doctor. I mean, there would be very little argument. I can't imagine a reasonable argument against those suggestions at all.
I think that's right, other than sometimes they may cost a little bit more, but I believe in the long run it's to the benefit of all.
Okay. And again, my fear is that there's perception that this panel or that some others may create, kind of coming back to the, you know, the earthquakes. Holy cow, you know, we're going to have this enormous event when we don't know that. And my fear is that the perception is that we would leave the American people that we have done something wrong, that we have been remiss in our environmental concerns up to this point. And I just don't think that's the case. I don't think the evidence supports that. And I appreciate that you would agree with that. With that being said, my time is up, and I back to you, Madam Chairman, Chairwoman.
Thank you, Chairman Stewart. The chair now recognizes Ms. Bonamici.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I have several questions and very little time, so I'm going to ask a few at a time and then allow you an opportunity to respond. So the first question is to Dr. Russ. I want to follow up on your testimony about water availability research, where you said that the USGS will develop water budgets to understand how much water is required to produce UOG deposits. So when you are analyzing the suitability of different communities, do you take into account the local economy's water needs, both present and future, to support potential future economic growth? So hold that. And then my next question is to Dr. Teichman. Dr. Teichman, yesterday in the Environment Subcommittee, we held a hearing on policy-relevant issues related to climate change. We discussed the impacts of greenhouse gas emissions on the planet. And all of the witnesses who testified agreed that anthropogenic climate change is happening and we need to take action to address it. Now, one concern I've heard about hydraulic fracturing is the possibility of fugitive emissions of methane gas. So I wanted you to please describe what the EPA is doing with your ongoing studies into the potential of fugitive emissions of methane from hydraulic fracturing. And then finally, for all of the panel, we've had in the Environment Subcommittee several discussions about stakeholder input, which is an important issue when discussing scientific and environmental and public health issues. Now, obviously, there's been some miscommunication and misinformation regarding hydraulic fracturing. So will you please detail what efforts you've made to get input from stakeholders related to your research plan, and also what you're planning to do to communicate and reach out to the public to ensure that the general public and stakeholders are informed about what you're doing? So starting with Dr. Russ on the water.
Thank you. Water availability and the development of water budgets, we feel, is a critical component to understand the amount of water that's used, actually, in the overall operations of hydraulic fracturing and related activities. And, yes, the water availability takes a look at all of the uses of water, surface water, groundwater, including the water that's needed to supply normal communities with the waters that they need, whether it's drinking water, irrigation, or whatever. So it does include all of these sources.
And also, do you consider the potential future to support economic growth in a particular community?
Yes, socioeconomics is a part of the study.
Thank you very much. Dr. Teichman on the
Fugitive emissions.
Right.
Indeed, that is a concern that we have, but we actually believe the industry shares with us that we should not have such methane stray emissions occurring as part of the drilling process. And therefore, I believe, although this is somewhat out of my bailiwick, more into the policy side as opposed to the research, that we have a new source performance standard on well completion that therefore would minimize the methane emissions associated with the completion of wells, and such that the material that would be collected by the industry in so saving those methane emissions could actually reap greater benefits than the cost to do so.
Thank you. And for the panel, did you want to add something?
Well, no, I was just going to go to your second question.
Terrific.
For the panel.
I'll
be very brief because I can spend too much time on this. But in part of the EPA drinking water study, just to give you an example, in our development of the study plan for it, there were four public stakeholder meetings, an email box set up, public comment was offered on the draft study plan. The SAB consulted and had an opportunity for public comment then from the stakeholders. The SAB had a peer review of the study plan. There were technical workshops, webinar, a docket was set up, a listserv, and that's just on the study plan. We've had the same type of external outreach on our study conduct.
Thank you. Others on the panel, would you please comment on stakeholder input and communication to the public?
Yes, as we've gone through the plans and preparation of our draft research plan, we've had webinars with industry, with states, with academia, and others, non-governmental organizations. We have, in addition, participated in many professional meetings and other community meetings that have asked about what we're looking at, including in our research plan. Particularly, we've worked with states through things like River Basin Commissions and participated in their meetings to understand the potential effects and water use of hydraulic fracturing. So we take their comments into consideration when we build our ideas for the report.
Thank you. And the others, I have a bit of time left. Mr. DeHaritis?
Yes, the Department of Energy participated in both the EPA activities and USGS activities, especially in terms of the webinars and presentations that were made. We've had also additional interactions with industry and participated in several, you know, public professional organizations, you know, their societies that we have given presentations at the Society of Petroleum Engineers and other professional activities.
Thank you.
And I'll just mention a few activities along these lines, not necessarily related to the research plan, but so, for example, the project that I mentioned during my testimony that NIEHS is supporting, that does, they're looking at information needs from the community. So that's one activity. Another is that part and parcel of our standard operating procedures when we work at the sites that I mentioned is to communicate findings back to the community and address any concerns or questions that they might have at that time. And then I would also add that NIOSH works very closely with industry, and the silica example that I mentioned in my testimony have also worked very closely to communicate findings with workers along with the industry partners.
Thank you. And I see my time has expired. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. And the Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Hall.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And I'd like to use a lot of my time telling you how very proud I am of you. And I'm going to again thank our chairman, Chairman Smith, for selection of you as to head this committee, because you're doing a wonderful job. You asked the proper questions. You didn't get proper answers. I just want to say, when it comes to hydraulic fracturing, EPA has gained notoriety for using just driven science and living allegations that later have to be retracted and have been retracted. I think certainly several examples, such as Dimrock, Pennsylvania, Parker County, Texas, and Pavilion, Wyoming, chairperson alluded to, where it appears that the agency is more interested in rushing judgment and placing information in the hands of the media than they are looking for sound scientific approach. I just think that it's pitiful. And then when they mention the First Lady of, and we invited her to come before us, Lisa Jackson, we had to do everything but threaten to subpoena her to get her, and finally got an agreement from her to appear at 10 o'clock one morning. That 10 o'clock happened to be the day that the Supreme Court guessed wrong on Obamacare, and she was a member of that had to be with the president that day, so she escaped that. And Lisa Jackson came before this committee and made the statement that they were not in the business of creating jobs. And I think that's one of the meanest things I've ever heard anybody testify to here at a time when men are having to go home and face their families. They can't send their daughter to school, or they can't keep their son in school, or they can't continue to feed their own family. I just think we're in a critical time. And when the EPA and answered to Congressman Rohrabacher, asked him, he asked the question, do you know of anywhere, anytime, when fracturing has caused the mistreatment of drinking water? Every one of them said no, nowhere in the United States. And Mr. Teichman, in May of 2012, Fred Hockman, who was director of the EPA's Office of Science Policy, said that the agency is, quote, doing a pretty comprehensive look at all the statutes to determine where there are some holes to justify further regulation of hydraulic fracturing. I guess my question to you is, Mr. Teichman, can you assure this committee at the EPA will not use the steering committee or the broader interagency working group to search for holes or engage in a search for ways to regulate hydraulic fracturing, rather than trying to help Congress find some way to support jobs and seek for jobs? And you've come to my state, and you came to my state, and without yielding to scientific, and I would like to remind you, sir, that you're under oath when you come here, and that there's a statute of limitations when you mislead a congressional committee. That statute has not run. It won't run till we have a new president. And I'm really proud of the chair for taking you on. I guess ask that one question to you as to whether or not you can assure the committee that the EPA is not going to use false and unrelated testimony that you later have to go back on, or that the courts have to turn you around on. And both of those things have happened, have they not?
I can't speak to the testimony of others at EPA. I can tell you that I signed for this committee the truth in whatever the official term is of the document. I apologize, and I'm glad to have done so, and there's nothing I have said here, to the best of my knowledge, is not totally truthful, nor will it be for the rest of the answer to this question. The answer to your question, I believe, is in my testimony, where the research that we are doing at EPA, if you were to ask me who the intended audience is, it is indeed federal agencies. It's also state, local, and tribal governments. It's also the oil and gas industry, and it's also the general public. And I believe those are the policymakers, not me as the researcher, who will make the decisions on policymaking. And I am hoping to provide research results that inform all of their thinking in the soundest possible way.
Well, I don't know whose direction you're following, but when you come here and give us bad science backup for your testimony, that gives me some question about what your attitude is. And one of the young ladies up there said that your job is to protect the citizens, and that's what you're trying to do. Our job is to also protect jobs and to be sure that we have proper science when decisions are made that affect this entire country. I think my time's up. I'll just leave with this. One of the horses next Saturday in the Kentucky Derby, there's a horse named Frack Daddy. F-R-A-C-D-A-D-D-Y, and he has the same odds that you have with me. He's a 45-1 long shot. I yield back my time.
I thank the gentleman from Texas and recognize Mr. Vesey.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and wanted to talk with you specifically about this issue. And I don't know if you've heard me speak before the committee before, but I really sort of represent a very unique perspective when it comes to urban when it comes to drilling, because most of the drilling that I know about, or that I'm more familiar with, I will say, happens in an urban setting. I live in Fort Worth, Texas, which is basically the hub of the Barnett Shale. And so, I mean, I live in a city with 700 plus thousand people, but I have frack ponds, pipelines, compressor stations, you name it, in neighborhoods. And so it's certainly a difference, because I can tell you that while this issue has been controversial in other areas, including Fort Worth, it's not controversial in Midland, Texas, where it's a part of the everyday life and basically makes up their entire economy. And so what I wanted to ask you specifically, because I have about 438 active wells in my district right now, and wanted to ask you, has any of your research been centered on the effects of natural gas in a urban setting? Because another reason why that's so important is that back in 2005, it really took off in Fort Worth, but now you're going to start seeing more of that take place in Dallas County as well, possibly.
Right. Well, one of the things that we're doing at the Department of Energy is promoting research and dealing with air emissions, especially in areas where there may be associated gas that is being flared. And so we're definitely looking at technology to control and mitigate those emissions, whether it's dealing with improved flaring operations or alternatives to flaring, beneficial use of the natural gas that may be associated with oil production from shale oil formations, and also emission capture technology. So I think that's the technology work that at the Department of Energy we're doing that's going to focus more on urban areas.
Okay. Dr. Tishman, do you have anything on the urban drilling and specifically?
Specifically, I'm not aware that any of the case studies, either retrospective or prospective, are intentionally in an urban area, but I could be wrong, and I would like to double check that and offer the answer for the record.
Okay. Wanted to talk with you about drought. As you know, specifically in Texas right now, we are experiencing droughts. We've had situations to where, people have, they're not taking as many cattle as they were before to feedlots and things like that. So, I mean, we're really experiencing that problem. And I know that that freshwater reserves in Texas has really been an issue lately. And I know that fracking uses only roughly about 1% of the freshwater reserves in our state right now. But it was estimated to use about 9% of the fresh water annually in one of the cities in the Barnett Shale area. The water needs for natural gas will obviously continue to grow, but as you probably are also familiar, our area in the state, the Dallas-Fort Worth area, is one of the fastest growing areas in the entire region, so we're obviously going to continue to need to look for water for an increasing population in the Metroplex. Will any of the research that you plan include information for water recycling?
Yeah, I believe that question also was raised in a slightly different form, and the answer is yes. To the extent that we can recycle wastewater so that we don't need to continuously use new water sources for the hydraulic fracturing, we will look into that practice, and hopefully it will prove to be very fruitful for all parties. It will save water use, and it will probably save expense, in fact, for the industries that are developing the resource.
And let me just say this also. The earthquake issue has been something that has been covered quite extensively in our local newspaper. Obviously, when, you know, there were never any earthquakes, and as someone that is a lifelong resident of the Metroplex, I can tell you that we never had any earthquakes, and all of a sudden we have a lot of earthquakes. They have been very, you know, small earthquakes. I think the last one that we had recently was about was measured at about 2.6 or so. But we have had the earthquakes. One scientist from the city of Cleburne, which I know that Ralph Hall knows about the city of Cleburne, that the city, they hired him. He came in and said to one of the newspapers that yes, there is earthquakes. There may be earthquakes associated with drilling. And then, you know, told the other newspaper, there may be earthquakes associated with drilling, but it wouldn't hesitate me to sell my minerals and let them drill on my land. So in regards to the earthquakes, how serious of an issue do you think it is or not? And particularly in specificity to the size of the earthquakes that we have been, you know, seeing these 2.6s or lower, maybe a little bit higher. Can you give me some your thoughts on that particular issue?
And quickly, because yes, the time is expired.
Thank you, Madam
yes,
Chair.
You bet.
Yes, very quickly. A very good question. One of our goals is to understand through research just how large of an earthquake might be induced by underground injection of fluids. And so this understanding of the injection rates and volumes and how that might affect the types of earthquakes, the distribution of earthquakes, is part of what we are working on. There's been some earthquakes in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. You were asked about urban areas a moment ago, and there's an earthquake that occurred in Youngstown, Ohio, that we're studying as well, so that's an urban area. So we don't have the answers to these questions yet. It's a complex topic, but it's one of the issues we're looking at.
I thank the witness, and I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Weber.
Well, thank you, Madam Chairman. I'm a little late in getting here, and so I really don't have a lot of questions. I think my colleague over here, also from Texas, was able to get some questions and extract a pound of flesh, so I think I'll leave it at that. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Weber. We have about 10 minutes until votes. And we've completed one round of testimony. If others are interested, I would suggest that we give each of us the opportunity to ask one more question, just one question. Is that agreeable?
Sure.
Yeah. I thank the ranking member, and the chairman yields to herself to ask a question. I note in what you've told me that you're spending money to implement this plan on looking at fracking, and yet we haven't seen the plan. And I look back at what my opening remarks. The agency's committed to release a draft of the research plan in October, final plan in January. We haven't even received a draft version. You're spending money to implement the plan. I want the plan. Will you please commit to give us the plan?
Chairman Lummis, with all due respect, the plan is under development. As soon as I am able to have it released, I will get it to you.
Well, but you know, the logical follow-up question is, why are you spending money to implement a plan that you haven't released to the public or given for public comments? And that's my question. And now I yield to...
May I respond? I apologize. But in FY 2013, which is when we are indeed spending dollars for our drinking water study, that is consistent with the money we have. It's the plan will be for FY 2014, where no dollars have been spent yet.
I thank the gentleman. Yield to Mr. Swalwell.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wanted to ask Mr. DeHoritis. My understanding is that investments that your office has made in hydraulic fracturing as far as research and development decades ago can be directly linked to the oil and gas boom that we're seeing today. And if that is the case, would you say that this provides a clear example of how federally funded applied energy research can have a major impact on establishing or accelerating the development of new energy technologies that are critically important to our nation?
Well, thank you very much. You know, DOE was working in shale gas research back as early as 1978, before it was even a thought in most people's minds that we could produce oil from shale formations, oil and gas. So DOE is very proud of that. Our efforts today are taking it what we think is the next step forward, looking at mitigation technologies. How can we do it and improve? Just as technology has advanced on the production side, we want to make sure that technology is advancing on the performance side. And so we're looking at better ways to reduce the amount of water that we need. How can we reuse water? How can we find alternatives to water? What about the air emissions? Can we do things in that area? Can we better understand the impacts of wastewater injection that may induce seismicity? So we're doing research in all these areas, and we feel that this is a very important research topic for us.
Great. Thank you. And I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you. We've been joined by a member of the committee who hasn't had a chance to ask questions, so I will yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Grayson.
Thank you very much. I have some questions for Dr. Ikeda. And this has to do with the ATSDR's activities with regard to the island of Vieques in Puerto Rico. Are you familiar with the ATSDR's activities regarding Vieques?
Yes.
All right. Is it fair to say that it's within scientific knowledge that the military has released toxins in various places, including Vieques and elsewhere, where the military has done bombing? Is it fair to say that we know to a scientific certainty that the military has released toxins into the environment in areas that it's done bombing?
We're focused on the human health aspects of environmental exposures, and our work in Vieques has not documented human health exposures or human health, you know, impacts related to military activities in Vieques.
Okay, Doctor. My question was, is it fair to say within a scientific certainty that bombing has led to environmental damage through the release of toxins? That's my question.
I can't speak to the environmental damage. Our focus is on the human health aspects of exposures in the environment.
All right. Is it fair to say, Doctor, to a scientific certainty that the release of mercury into the environment can cause human health damage?
So mercury has been associated with negative health impacts, yes.
And the same thing is true of Agent Orange, right?
Yes, correct.
And the same thing is true of depleted uranium, right?
Yes.
And the same thing is true of napalm, right?
Yes.
All right. Now, can you tell me how much napalm was released in Vieques during the half century of bombing by the Navy?
I'm sorry. I don't have that information.
Do you have any idea?
I don't know. No, we'd have to get back to you.
Can you tell me how much depleted uranium was released on Vieques during a half a century of bombing by the Navy?
Again, I'm sorry. I don't have that information.
Does anybody within your agency have that information?
I certainly will check and get back.
Can you tell me how much Agent Orange was used and released into the environment at Vieques over the course of half a century?
Again, I'm sorry.
Can you identify for me with specificity any of the environmental toxins that do cause damage to human health that you know or don't know was released into the environment at Vieques at any time in the past 60 years?
I couldn't do that with any specificity, so we'd have to get that information back to you.
All right. Is it fair to say that you really can't make a firm judgment or even a wild guess as to whether there's been damage to health, human health in Vieques without knowing what toxins were released, when, and how much?
So I'm sorry that I don't know the specifics about the report, but the final results from the report have shown that there were not human health impacts related to the military activities in Vieques.
Doctor, if you don't know whether or how much Agent Orange was released, how could you possibly reach that conclusion?
No, I'm saying that I'm sorry that I personally don't have the information, but the information in the report is final.
Well, Doctor, I'll represent to you that nobody in that report, involved in that report, which to some degree preceded your time at the agency, nobody working on that report at ATSDR, as far as I know, knew the answer to that question. Nobody knows at ATSDR how much Agent Orme was released. Nobody knows how much napalm was released. It wasn't in the report. Now, given that fact, given the fact that you were not told exactly what toxins were released by the military during the bombing, is it fair to say that we don't really know with a firm answer whether the bombing caused any health damages on the island or not?
Again, I would say that based on the information that we do have, we did not find evidence of human health impacts, negative human health impacts related to the military bombing.
Doctor, if you know nothing, then really you can't say anything, right?
I'll stand by my answer again. I'm sorry, I don't have the personal information, but according to our report and the work that we've done and the data that we do have.
I'll ask you to assume hypothetically, since you don't have that information here with you today, if the Navy has not released the information to you or the people of Vieques or even to us in Congress, the information about how much of these toxins were released during their bombing, is it fair to say then that you cannot reach any firm, final scientific conclusions without the information that you need in order to be able to reach that conclusion?
Again, I would say that based on the information that we have, we believe that our conclusions are valid.
Based on that information that you have, which you know isn't...
The gentleman's time has expired.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
I will now yield to the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Mr. Grayson, your comment that if you know nothing, you can't say anything, very clearly, sir, you've never raised teenagers, because I have several of them who...
Quite well taken.
I only have a few minutes. I'd like to follow up just in a big picture, kind of a general sort of way. And again, it's something that I think we would agree with, but I would like to caution us if we could. And that is that in regarding to fracking and the research and the science and the development of the technology around that, and the EPA has repeatedly insisted, and we appreciate this, that you are trying to be transparent and research-driven as you approach this. And thank you for doing that. And it's important that you do that. But there are examples where that appears to not have taken place, and I won't elaborate them here. We've discussed some of them already in the committee. But there are times when it appeared that the agency is more interested in rush judgments and placing, and this is particularly troubling, placing information in the hands of the media rather than undertaking a sound scientific approach. And in just the few seconds that I have, I would ask you to agree that's detrimental to what we're all trying to do here, and that it invites suspicion as to the agency's motivation. And if I could have your commitment that the agency would do everything in its power to work within the normal protocols and to not put information out there. Like, frankly, I'm afraid that this committee has done, or this hearing has done today in regard to, as I said, in regards to earthquakes, to not put a perception or a partial information out there that the media then, of course, runs with and does what the media does. And I'd appreciate your commitment that you'll do everything within your power to try to avoid that.
I believe that's probably most directed to me.
Yes, sir.
And I would say that EPA has been and will continue to be committed to performing all of its research in strict conformance with the highest standards of scientific quality as promoted by our own EPA scientific integrity policy and related policies. And you're hearing that from the person who helped write the scientific integrity policy for EPA.
Okay, and again, we appreciate that. And if we could have this science based once again and go through the normal protocols rather than in some cases where it has been partial information, or in some cases, absolutely inaccurate information, has been provided to the press and allowed them to create great concerns among local populations that just didn't bear out. So, thank you for your commitment to doing that. And, Madam Chair, I yield back.
I thank the gentleman from Utah, and the chair now recognizes Ms. Bonamici.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wanted to ask about the cooperation that you're getting from the industry and get back to the topic of earthquakes, because that's something that we've heard from a couple of members here. And I know that there's a William Ellsworth who is with the USGS, or was a geophysicist. I don't know if he's still with the USGS, but has written more than 100 papers on earthquakes and reviewed a study. Mr. Ellsworth studied geophysics at Stanford, earned his doctorate from MIT, former president of the Seismological Society of America. When he was asked if there was any doubt among his colleagues about what produced quakes in Arkansas, Colorado, Ohio, Oklahoma, and Texas, he said injection of wastewater into Class II wells has induced earthquakes, including those you cite. In my opinion, it's pretty clear in all of these cases, Youngstown, Arkansas, DFW, Trinidad, and Oklahoma, that injection wells were the cause. So obviously, there are people who are experts who are making this connection. Have you been able to get information from the industry that would help you form opinions about that, for example, the amount of water, what they're using, and how they're injecting the water? Thank you.
Yes, I'll take a stab at answering that. This is Dr. Russ. And yes, Dr. Ellsworth is a geophysicist with our offices in Menlo Park, California. He's still very much an active member of that unit. And I think he's done a good job at summarizing and looking at the evidence to support the relationship between the activities of subsurface injection and earthquakes that you mentioned.
Thank you. And are you, as working on this report and this plan, this research, are you able to get the information you need from the industry about what they're injecting, how much they're injecting, and what their process is?
We've been successful getting some of the information we think is necessary. We would like to have more information of the rates of pumpage, volumes of water injected. In some cases, companies haven't recorded that information. So we're trying to work with the companies and with the Environmental Protection Agency to see how we can improve our ability to get some of that important information.
Dr. Teichman, do you want to weigh in on this, please?
I would only add to Dave's remarks that as part of our drinking water study, we have two prospective studies that we are hoping to have, in which case we will be there measuring baseline data of water quality before fracking occurs at a site, while it is occurring, and even after wells are completed and, in fact, the production is stopped. And we hope by that time to be there and getting the very type of data you're talking about and measuring the potential environmental impact, if any, as we do that.
Well, thank you. And I hope that the industry is cooperative, because the more facts that you have, the more data you have, the more you'll be able to have accurate reports that you can get back to us. Thank you very much. I yield back. Thank you, Madam Chair.
I thank the gentlelady from Oregon and the gentleman from California as well, our ranking members, our attendance, and the attendance of the minority as well as the majority members is deeply appreciated. I also want to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony and the members for their questions. The members of the committee may have additional questions for you, and we will ask you to respond to those in writing. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments and written questions from members. Again, with my deepest thanks to the witnesses today, you are now excused, and this hearing is adjourned.